Thank you and hello. My name is Trevor Hughes. I'm the President and CEO of the International Association of Privacy Professionals. We are the world's largest professional association serving people working in this burgeoning, if not exploding, field of privacy. I have the opportunity to spend a lot of time talking about privacy around the world, and over the years I've found that privacy is a really difficult topic to explain. It does not lend itself to easy definitions, and sometimes wrapping our heads around this idea through the words we give ourselves in the law or the words we give ourselves in business doesn't really get the job done. And so what I've found is that sometimes a picture speaks louder than words. A picture may say 1,000 words when words just won't suffice. So what I'd like to do with you today is give you a very short glimpse into what's happening in the world of privacy right now, and do it through the world of art. We'll use that as a lens, as an introductory point, a launching off point for us to talk about some of the top issues. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to talk about data in society today. This is Jasper Johns. It's at the Museum of Modern Art in New York City, and it's called The White Alphabet. And I use it to demonstrate the idea that data permeates everything. Data aggregates in enormous quantities today. We collect more data every year than we have in all years prior. And the march of technology, the march of business practices, continually challenge the tools that we have to manage data and to manage privacy. So we are going to look at a number of issues, not 20. We're going to spend 20 minutes looking at privacy issues in 2013. So let's start. This is The Indebted States of America by Eric Lapinen. He's an artist based in Maine. It's actually on loan to the IAPP and hangs in our offices right now. Eric Lapinen, over the course of 23 years, collected all of the credit cards that he and his wife received through the mail, and in a moment of inspiration, decided to create an American flag out of all of those credit cards. So he veneered, washed over the credit cards with red, white, and blue. I use it as a way for us to start talking about that primary consumer protection regulator in the United States, the Federal Trade Commission. The Federal Trade Commission is the cop on the beat when it comes to privacy. And as the cop on the beat, they have taken a very clear focus on the issue of privacy. They have a very full pipeline of privacy cases, and we have seen many, many privacy cases over the last months. In fact, we've seen almost one a month. Now, the FTC just recently had a change of leadership. Chairman Leibowitz stepped down, and a new chairman has been appointed, Chairman Ramirez. Chairman Leibowitz was very clearly a privacy champion. I think it is fair to say that Commissioner Ramirez, and now Chairman Ramirez, has shown herself to be as much a privacy advocate and perhaps even more than Chairman Leibowitz before her. As a result, I think we can expect from the Federal Trade Commission more of the same, more aggressive actions in the space of privacy. And we're going to talk about some of the things that the FTC has been doing in a few of the slides coming up. One of the things that the FTC has been promoting is the idea of do not track. This is a piece by Shepard Fairey. He's a graffiti artist based in the United States. He is famous for creating that iconic image of Barack Obama with hope underneath it. This is a piece that is called Your Eye Here. And I think it's a great example of this idea of do not track. Do not track is a relatively simple concept. Your browser can send out a signal, a single header that says, do not track, :1. And that means you don't want to be tracked. Now, the simplicity of it is kind of beautiful and kind of compelling, seductive even. However, the devil is in the details when it comes to something like do not track. And the implementation of do not track in the marketplace, I think it is fair to say, has been rather messy. Microsoft is shipping IE10 right now. And IE10 includes a do not track feature, which is on in the default. that created enormous consternation in the internet advertising industry. And there have been enormous debates associated with the default in the Microsoft browser. We are also seeing other initiatives through the browser, though, where privacy is really a battleground, or the browser is a battleground for privacy. Mozilla just this week announced that the Firefox browser will include a patch and soon a feature that will block third-party cookies by default. That means that many analytics cookies, many ad-serving cookies, will not be served through the Firefox browser eventually. A representative from the Interactive Advertising Bureau, the IAB, in a tweet called this a nuclear first strike. So make no mistake, there is a battle brewing, if not already engaged, over this idea of do not track. And whether it's right or wrong, the way that it's shaping up is browser manufacturers versus online advertising. Although some of those browser manufacturers, Google, Microsoft, Apple, sit in both seats at the same time and have to sort of argue with themselves in that debate. Now, one of the biggest spaces for privacy right now, and one of the most challenging and difficult spaces for us to address, is mobile. And mobile is not a single thing. This is a piece by an artist in Boston named Nikki Rosado. She calls it Connections. She takes images of her friends, beams them up onto posters, and then uses an X-Acto knife to carve out their images to suggest that our identity, our personality, is very much connected to the geographies in which we live. I use it as a way for us to start talking about the topic of mobile. Now, I mentioned that the FTC has been very active. In fact, they've been very active very recently in the space of mobile. The FTC released proposed guidelines for the various actors in the mobile space. And what was interesting was that the FTC did it in a very sophisticated way. They recognized that blanket omnibus rules for mobile were not going to work. So what did they do? They broke down the guidelines by the various actors in the space, the carriers, the platform providers, the device manufacturers, the apps and services that flow through those devices and platforms. And they suggested the types of things that those participants in this ecosystem would need to be paying attention to. Very, very powerful stuff. We have seen similar activity focused on apps from the California Attorney General's office. And I think it's fair to say that the area of mobile will continue to be a challenging space because there are so many actors. When you pull out your smartphone, you do have apps on your phone, which represent multiple actors, a platform associated with your phone, which represents an actor, a device manufacturer, and a carrier. All of those parties are active in the data that flows through that device and how that device works for you. That makes it an incredibly challenging environment to solve privacy and data protection issues in. The other thing that's challenging with mobile is the user interface. It's small, and it doesn't lend itself to some of the traditional solutions that we have. Privacy has traditionally been dealt with through notice and choice. We've all seen those long privacy policies that really nobody reads on websites or in credit card statements. That really doesn't work on a mobile device. And I think we will start to see more icons, more just-in-time notice, where things pop up as particular data practices are occurring. So watch mobile. It is a very hot space. This is a piece called Privacy, and it's by an artist named Alexander Balos. I like it because it really demonstrates the tension that exists with privacy. Sociologists would tell us that privacy is how much data we share with society and how much we keep for ourselves. And in that act of sharing, in that balance between society and the identity of the individual, we create our identity. And so this piece has people with masks in an obvious contorted state, in a state of tension in that sociologist's balance. It's a very sophisticated piece, I think, and captures the tension of privacy well. In no other region and in no other public policy initiative are we seeing that tension play out more than the EU proposed regulation. Let me give you a quick bit of history on that. Europe, culturally is different than the United States. There are many, many reasons for it, but European law, European constitutional law, looks at privacy as a fundamental human right. As a result, Europe has long created broad omnibus privacy laws that apply to the entire European Union. The first major implementation of that at a European level was in 1995, the EU Data Protection Directive. Now let's think about that date, 1995. That law was drafted for the 5 years prior to 1995. It was passed in 1995. As a result, it really didn't capture what was about to happen with the broad consumer web. It really didn't capture what was about to happen with the explosion of the information economy and the explosion of data around the world. As a result, this major omnibus umbrella privacy law in Europe was almost dated the minute it came out. Well, Europe has worked to reconcile that issue and try to update its standards so as to make more effective the privacy protections that exist constitutionally and under the law in Europe. So 2 years ago, work began on a proposed regulation that would amend and update the standards previously put forward by the 1995 directive. There are a number of components within that proposed regulation that are quite controversial. Ideas like the right to be forgotten, ideas like 24-hour mandatory data breach notice, ideas like 2% of global turnover as maximum fine amounts when it comes to privacy violations. This will probably play out over the next 12 months, and we may have a new EU proposed regulation within that time period. So at the outside edge of 12 months, we may see this EU proposed regulation in force. And many of you who sit in American companies may be thinking, well, what does this have to do with me? I'm not really that worried about EU proposed regulations. Well, one of the interesting things about the EU is that they not only protect European data in Europe, they protect European data when it's outside of Europe as well. And there are prohibitions on data transfers outside of Europe to countries that Europe does not deem adequate from a data protection standpoint. As a result, things like cloud services, any contracting where data flows in an international way and touches Europe in some way, can be complicated, if not prevented, by the EU proposed regulation and, in fact, the directive from 1995. So, watch this space. Europe is a very hot zone when it comes to privacy. I want to turn now to some of the risks associated with privacy, and I want to share with you a biblical tale. This is Susanna and the Elders. The story goes like this. Susanna was a young wife, and she was bathing in a garden. Two dirty old men, voyeurs, spied upon her, and they tried to blackmail her. They said, if you don't sleep with us, we will tell the community that you were here with a young man who was not your husband. She refused to sleep with the two dirty old men, and they indeed told the community that she had been with another man, not her husband, in this garden. And Daniel of biblical fame, cross-examined the two elders and asked them about what had happened and found inconsistencies in their story. So instead of poor Susanna being stoned for and killed, executed for adultery, the two elders were executed for adultery. The moral of this tale, at least my moral, is mess up privacy, violate privacy, and get killed. Right? You will be killed if you violate privacy. And in fact, we are seeing that increasingly today. As I mentioned, the FTC has a very full pipeline of privacy cases, and they continue to enforce. Now, the dollar amounts associated with the fines in those cases are notable. Some of them are in the many millions, if not tens of millions, of dollars. However, most of the FTC enforcement actions that we have seen include something even more significant, and that is 20 years of privacy audits by a third-party independent auditor that reports back to the FTC. And if you think it's bad to have to go to tell your CEO that you're going to have to pay a $10 million fine, It is so much worse to have to tell your CEO that for every 2 years, for the next 20 years, you're going to have independent auditors in your organization looking at your data protection practices and reporting back to the primary privacy cop in the United States. That is a very significant consequence. Watch the FTC enforcement actions. Read them carefully. They are creating what equates to precedent in the field of privacy. In the absence of broad-based privacy law in the United States, those FTC enforcement actions are incredibly influential. We saw one just this week. We saw one 2 weeks ago. I expect that we will see them increasingly over the course of this year. It's not just the FTC, though. California Attorney General has gotten active. Health and Human Services with HIPAA, our major healthcare privacy law, has gotten active. I expect regulators will be increasing their enforcement activity in the months and years ahead. Watch enforcement. It is a risk vector that your organizations cannot ignore. Let me share another risk vector with you. This is Ed Ruscha, and it is what it is. It's an invasion of privacy. Ed Ruscha is playing with the very words, talking about an invasion of privacy. I use it as a way for us to talk about class action lawsuits. Now, the class action bar, the plaintiff's bar in the United States, has long been a secondary consumer watchdog in this country. They go after faulty automobiles. They go after damaging or harmful pharmaceuticals. They go after children's toys that create choking hazards or injuries for children. The plaintiff's bar has long looked at this issue of privacy and wanted to or tried to go after the issue of privacy. The primary barrier has been the concept of harm. It's difficult to quantify the harm of privacy. If your privacy is violated, what's that worth? And the courts don't have a really good way to apply a dollar value to that privacy violation. So that has always been a barrier to class action lawsuits. If there's nothing to be gained from the lawsuit financially, there's not a lot of incentive to move forward with the lawsuit. Courts are starting to show a little bit of flexibility, and certainly the plaintiff's bar is starting to show a lot of innovation and creativity in trying to define harm in different ways so as to allow those cases to go forward. So watch class action lawsuits. We are seeing multi-million dollar settlements already in privacy class action lawsuits. This is a space that will be very, very active. You may dismay at this point and think, my goodness, there is so much to worry about. And in fact, we have just touched the very tip of the top of the iceberg on privacy. There are literally hundreds of issues percolating around the world. There is an incredibly complex risk matrix that exists. We haven't even talked about ideas of competitive threats, where privacy is becoming a competitive differentiator. We haven't talked about media threats, where privacy can be a real challenge to an otherwise stellar brand. And so the question then becomes, what do you do? How do you respond to these big concerns about privacy? And unfortunately, the first answer is there is no single answer. Anyone who tries to tell you that they have a silver bullet, a magic tonic, a piece of technology, an app for that, they're wrong. There is not an app for that. There is not a silver bullet. Privacy is not easy. And what I'd like to suggest to you is that the only solution is for us to understand that we are at the nascent stage of the information economy. And at that nascent stage, it is incumbent upon all of us to understand the risks associated with data, the challenges associated with privacy, in a much, much more sophisticated way. Your organization may have a chief privacy officer. I certainly hope that they do. Your organization may have lawyers who look after compliance with the various privacy laws around the world. I expect that you would and should. However, every IT professional, every InfoSec professional, every product development manager, every customer service person sitting in a customer phone bank talking to your customers needs to know enough about privacy so that they don't make a stupid decision that creates undue risk for your organization. Make no mistake, you need to educate and make your employees aware about the risks associated with data. It is much too easy to do something stupid in a very quick and otherwise innocent way. We are the world's largest privacy organization, and we're here to help. This is our website. I certainly look forward to continuing this dialogue and continuing to grow the field and profession of privacy in the future, and I thank you for your time today.